Why don't you take your Bible now and open to the book of Ephesians. We've been looking at the verses that I was trained as a boy in witnessing to use. The Romans Road, yes, use several verses in Romans. Another verse to use would be, or two verses would be, in Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. If you come to someone and you ask that prodding question, would qualify you to entrance in heaven? So if you reach that gate, and let's say Peter met you there, and Christ met you there, and Christ said, what reason should I have let you into my heaven? And if the answer comes out, well, I've been a good person, I've gone to church, I've been baptized, I've read my Bible thoroughly, hey, how can you keep me out? Use these verses, Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, and this morning even verse 10. What do the verses say? For by grace, it says, for by grace are ye saved, through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. And then notice verse 10. Just these words at the beginning, five words here. For we are his workmanship. Let's pray. Our Lord, we need to have your Spirit, please, work in our hearts always as we approach your word. No less of importance is this time when we're with many others. The distractions are real, our thoughts meander. Certainly Satan works, our flesh cries out, our Father, we need your blessing. Help us, O God, to see the usefulness and the truth of these verses. Help us to see them applied by your Spirit to our living. And we pray, God, that we will honor you by careful use of these words. We pray your blessing, we look with expectation, and we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. When you look at the various parts of Scripture, no doubt if you've done some serious reading at all, you come across elements and you say, why is this here? Why is this lengthy section of genealogy here? Or why is this here? This sounds just like another story I heard over here in the Gospels elsewhere. What are the differences? What did God intend as he put this in the Word? What did he expect for me to gain from this? What might I share of this with others? Our passage this morning, for many of us who have been believers for a long time, this seems like a very simple, simplistic almost, passage, because we have gone through that threshold of belief in the truth of Christ. And we have indeed admitted our sin, and we have, why, it never occurred to us that we really could somehow earn our way to heaven. Well, the Bible, I think, has these verses to make sure that there is no question unanswered in this regard, and that there is no doubt in our minds as regards our contribution to our holy God as regards our salvation. What does it say? Ephesians 2, verse 8. It says plainly, for by grace are ye saved. It says that it is the work of God. We have defined grace as the giving of God, God's riches, G-R, at Christ's expense. Grace, God's riches at Christ's expense. And many of us have come to Christ. We have never doubted that we have been the beneficiaries of such an act of grace that God has sent his Son to pay a price for our sin, a price that we could not pay and survive. And has done so out of love for us. And this verse says, indeed, verse 8 goes on, our part is only to believe, to trust. Our part is but faith. Paul goes on in verse 8 and says, and that not of yourselves. It is not salvation, is the meaning of that word that. It's referring to the whole thing of salvation. Salvation is not something that is of ourselves. And we wonder, why is this here? Maybe we need reminding. Maybe we read this relatively short book of the Bible, the book of Ephesians, and read verses 8, 9, and 10, and we read them again, we stumble on it by mistake. It's at a place that has become well-worn, maybe in our Bible, and we read it again. Maybe we need a reminder. Because we are apt very often to take for ourselves credit for that which is not our due. And before God, that is a dangerous thing to do, because all the glory belongs unto Him. But many of us envision that someday we'll be before God, and perhaps at the judgment seat, and we will justify ourselves. We will present our case. We'll work as our own advocate, and we'll speak, we'll preach on our own behalf for eternity's sake. And we'll include such items as how we've been faithful. We've been a good friend. We have honored Christ and loved you in the name, that word, that name, Jesus Christ. And we have been devoted to His Word. We have read the Scriptures. And we have attended faithfully God's local house. We have served and loved the unworthy. We have sacrificed. We have served as Jesus apparently taught we ought. We will give our case. We will argue. And the Bible assures us we will fail. I'm glad this morning there should be no misunderstanding about this. You know, this is a little bit of a trap here this morning, because this is our subject, and maybe this is in the back of your mind, that somehow, maybe your parents even told you this or modeled this, that there was a goodness reachable by us human beings that would satisfy God and be indeed sufficient sacrifice for our sin. And that goodness would somehow outweigh our sin, and so that the day of judgment, our goodness, our righteousness, would be looked at God as acceptable before Him as account of our sin, and that our sins would be covered by those goodnesses, those good acts, those good righteous acts, and that God would bypass the due and proper judgment for our sin. My friends, we should give God thanks every day that it's not a matter of a weight and a scale. It's not something we can attain to. There is no amount of attractiveness in us to cause us to be desired by God. We have been chosen and worked on by Him, and it's all been a grace. It's always only been God's riches at Christ's expense. All of this for ours, not our doing, but His doing. And so I think one of the reasons these scriptures are here is that there's something accurate about these words. These words rather correctly ascribe to God His greatest work and achievement, and it gives to us nothing to praise ourselves concerning as regards it. The Bible says that God has saved us, and I'll tell you this morning, I'm very thankful the Bible says that plainly. By some of us in this room have been more gross in our sin than others. Would it be that God would make those who have lived more grossly in their sin, appropriately, proportionately, less likely to be admitted into glory? Could it be that there's a scale of sins, and ours have always been among the most acceptable, and we've even sought forgiveness somehow, hazily in our mind? We never intended to do those things, not really, not actively. Might God not forgive, and especially as I serve Him, as I love Him, as I try to represent Him? I am a Christian by my acts, by my living. You can hardly tell me apart from anybody else in church. But the Bible says clearly, hey, that's not the criteria in the mind of God. A good question is, look at our steeple. You know, many people over the years have come to our church. They've seen from the 7 train those words, lighted, depending on the time of the day, the words that say, Jesus saves. Nowhere in the Bible does it say there's something salvific about our goodness. God wants us to know, Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, that He is the one who has made salvation possible, and that salvation through the grace of God, by the sacrifice of Christ. and not a bit by our doing. And so when we look at these verses and accept them, we see how they correctly ascribe to God his great work in our salvation. And frankly, they say that we have contributed absolutely nothing. Why is it important to me? I can see why that's important to God, but he wants to make sure the record's straight. He wants to indeed receive praise, and he should, for what he has done. But why is it important for me? And the truth is, it's very important to me, and it should be to you, because to be wrong on this is to be wrong about everything as regards our God. Our God is not in it for the animals brought to sacrifice, or for the incense we light and let the smell rise up to the heavens. Our God is not into tithes and offerings as being the acceptable basis for our salvation. It frankly matters almost nothing whether you're sitting here in this room, whether you're a scholar as regards the Word of God, whether you attempt to be charitable, philanthropic, have a care for others, obey the golden rule. The Bible says, Jesus says, and what we do regarding him makes all the difference. Is it important to me? Yes, because if I trust the things of every other religion in this world, that it's a matter of good works outweighing bad works, then my end is judgment. Because the solution to it all, the hope that is available to all, has been offered, but I've chosen to go a different route. I refer to verses like in the book of Acts, neither is there salvation in any other, for there is no other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. And as nicely as I might be living my life, I'm still a sinner in a situation where I cannot please God unless I have first pleased him as regards his Son. Where does your hope lie? You know, it comes back to whose we are. Now, does anybody in our room, by the way, have a record collection? I know we use CDs, and someday they'll be all outdated also. Do you have a record collection? A few of them? They're worth a lot of money, but you know, most of the people in this room need to be instructed as to what that piece of wax is about. 33 and a third, I suppose. And somehow I've got a pile or two of those, and my wife has said at various times we could use the box, but we sell those. But somehow I resisted. And I have one of these, some of them I value. Some of them I don't want you to know what they include. I admitted in the first service this morning that I have an original multi 33 and third set of the original Woodstock. I have that on my. Of course, many of you have never touched a piece of vinyl or wax like that. You know what I'm going to talk about. I also like other kinds of teaching that come out of that kind of thing. One of the things I value very much is my favorite routine. Many of you have heard of Bill Cosby, who has been very powerful in television. And right now it's causing a lot of turmoil in the black culture over education, et cetera. I have an old copy. Now, this would be really great if somebody in this room also had something like this. But I have an old copy of a record that he called Russell, My Brother Whom I Slept With. Now, it turns out this is a based on true story, but when he was a little boy, Bill Cosby and his brother, approximately the same age, would do just like you and I did when we were kids. We were almost impossible to put to bed and get to sleep. And every night, Bill Cosby and Russell Cosby's dad would put the boys to bed, and he would retire to a room nearby, and Bill and Russell would just fool around like crazy. They would jump up and down in the bed. They would sing. They would push each other. They'd wrestle. They'd fall off the bed. Bang! And for about 9 or 10 minutes, Bill Cosby describes how they lived this way and failed to go to sleep this way. And finally, throughout the evening, several times, their dad would bust into the room and shout at them, "Go to bed, you guys, or I'll bring the belt!" And at one point, Bill Cosby said, "We never saw the belt, but you could always imagine it so that we got quickly into bed, and Dad would shuffle out. And then the boys would just so foolishly just get right back up there again. And they would do this for hours. They went to bed, I think the record says, about 7:30 at night. They were doing this for hours. And one time their dad came in, and Russell happened to say, as part of the argument about what was going on here, how important he was, or unimportant Bill was, and he inferred that Dad was his dad, but the dad was not the dad of Bill.